Hi everyone, welcome to Cool Ideas. Today, a purely mathematical video to describe the four-dimensional sphere. It's called the hypersphere because it is a sphere in the hyperspace, the four-dimensional space. A sphere is a set of points at the same distance to a center point. If there is only one dimension, the sphere is simply a couple of points. In two dimensions, you get a circle. With the third dimension, it becomes a sphere. And what about the fourth dimension and the hypersphere? The problem is that in our 3D space, there is no room for any other dimension. Wherever you try to put the fourth axis, it is always possible to obtain it using the three other existing axes. It's not possible to add a fourth independent axis, and this is the limit of our world. One could imagine that time represents this fourth dimension. We'll see later why this is not quite the case. Even if you cannot picture the 4D space, you can get an idea of it using a projection in our 3D space. This is what we do in this video. We don't have any problem saying that these three dimensions are independent. But in reality, they are drawn on a two-dimensional screen. If you stick to what is really drawn on the screen, you can obtain the blue axis from the red and the green ones. The blue direction is not independent from the two others. But changing the viewpoints reveals that this is an optical illusion. The red and grid lines lay on a horizontal plane and cannot reach the blue point. We use the word projection because it's like throwing the points to the screen along a direction. By changing the projection direction, we get another image which corresponds to different viewpoints. A 2D screen gives us a good representation of the 3D space. Now, let's try the same things in the hyperspace. We project the four axes into our space. The new black axis is set along the vertical direction. The angles between each pair of axes are right, but the projections deform them. When we change the direction of the projections, the axes move. The horizontal plane is formed by the red and green axes. The plane formed by the blue and black axes could be called the vertical plane. These planes are completely independent and they intersect at only one point, the origin of our coordinate system. In the 3D projection, it looks like their intersection were aligned, but it's an optical illusion. By changing the location of our hypercamera, the planes appear under a different perspective. We can see that what looked like the single intersection line was in fact two different 4D lines projected at the same place in the 3D space. Now that we know how to depict the hyperspace, let's try to make a projection of a hypersphere. A circle is projected into 1D as a segment, which is a filled 1D sphere. A sphere is projected into 2D as a disk, which is the filled 2D sphere. Logically, a hypersphere is projected as a filled 3D sphere, which is a ball. We have our representation of a hypersphere. Well, this is a bit disappointing. Let's try to go further to understand how this ball is made inside. How do we build a sphere of a higher dimension? Let's use the following method. To construct the circle, we start from a couple of points and we add couples along the new dimension, above and below, with a smaller and smaller radius. This gives a good approximation of the circle. Let's do the same for the sphere. We start with a circle and add more circles above and below, decreasing their size. This gives a nice sphere made of rings, the hypersphere now. So, we start with a sphere and add smaller and smaller spheres along the new black axis. This brochette is not very convincing. What's happening? In fact, the sphere we started with is not good. We have first to think how a 3D sphere, immersed in 4D space, is then projected back in our 3D space. Let's look at the sphere made of rings. There are circles, but what is drawn on the screen is ellipses, not circles. A 2D circle, immersed in 3D space, is then projected as an ellipse onto a 2D screen. The shape of the ellipse depends on the direction of projections, that is to say the angle under which we look at it. Since we will switch back and forth between 4D to 3D and 3D to 2D projections, let's take the time to better formalize this parallelism. We start with a 3D sphere. It's immersed into the 4D hyperspace. We then project this sphere into 3D space. Since we can't visualize the 4D space, we made a parallel, decreasing by one the dimension of each step. The 3D sphere reduced by one becomes a circle. It's immersed not in a 4D space but a 3D space, one dimension less. The result is projected onto a 2D space, the screen of our computer. Well, we can see that the circle plunged into 3D space and then projected on the screens gives an ellipse. It's still kind of a circle, but flattened. A sphere plunged into hyperspace and then projected to 3D space gives a flattened sphere. It's called an ellipsoid. Now, we can turn around the ellipsoid to see it from different angles. This ellipsoid is a view of the sphere in 4D space. Turning around the ellipsoid doesn't change the perspective. We only look at the result of the projection. We do not need to turn around the ellipse because we see all of it at a glance. If you want to see the circle from another angle, you have to move the camera. This changes the shape of the resulting ellipse. In the same manner, by moving our hyper camera in the 4D space, we change the perspective and so we change the shape of the resulting ellipsoid. But moving the hyper camera is a bit confusing because it moves the reference axis that orient us in the hyperspace. It is already tricky enough. There is another way to examine an object, to make it turn in front of the camera which itself remains at rest. To examine our circle, we don't have to go around it. We can also turn it around in front of the camera. To inspect our sphere, let's rotate it in front of our hyper camera. The shape of the ellipsoid changes by flattening and expanding. It can even become fully flat and take the form of a disc. Weird? Not really. When you look at the circle from the side, what you see is a segment. From this perspective, we see that a guy walking along the blue axis can reach the center of the sphere without being blocked by the surface. We know that in two dimensions, a flatlander who lives in 2D cannot reach the inside of the circle. He is blocked by the circumference. But if we plunge the circle into 3D space, we can rotate it. It frees a path for the flatlander. He can freely walk to the center. The circle then closes back without hurting the man. When the circle is closed, viewers from outside cannot see the man in the center. Let's see what happens with the sphere. We place the man on the blue axis. If we move our hyper camera, we can see he is on the surface of the sphere. Now, let's turn the sphere about the vertical plane. The surface appears to be shrinking, the flatlander walks a bit closer, and once again, he arrives against the surface. Still stuck? Not this time. If we move our hyper camera, we can see that the path is clear and that the visitor can pass to the center. Thus, he isn't at the surface of the sphere. It's an optical illusion, he can walk forward. If we can go inside without passing through the surface, it does mean that the sphere is an open shape in the hyperspace. But where is the hole? This is quite frustrating. We know that we have a shape into which we can enter, but we don't see the path. When we look at the projection of the circle, we can see the opening well and how to go inside the shape. Why is the ellipsoid different? If one can distinguish the inside from the outside of the circle, it is thanks to the color and the lightning. Yellow is the color of the interior, the lightning gives information about relief. But we don't have this information on the ellipsoid. Let's try to get them. When projecting the circle onto the screen of the camera, one can calculate whether it's the inside or the outside that is projected. We can easily compute this with the hypersphere. Let's see what happens. The ellipsoid becomes bicolor. One half is yellow, the other half is white. The yellow half is for the inside of the sphere, and the white half is for the outside. If we turn the sphere around in the hyperspace, the border between the two halves moves, but remains always the largest circle of the ellipsoid. It has the radius of the sphere. That's the same that happens with the circle. The boundary between the yellow semicircle and white semicircle is always the largest diameter. When the ellipsoid becomes completely flat, the color of the hemispheres reverse. Again, this is what happens with the circle. Can we see the inside of the sphere now? Unfortunately, no. To understand why, we need to add a column to the parallelism between the projection of the sphere and the one of the circle. We see the ellipsoid with our eyes. We cannot see all sides of the ellipsoid simultaneously. We can neither see simultaneously the inside and the outside. Human beings see in 2D. On the lower lines, everything is one-dimensionless. This means that the flatlanders see only in 1D. The flatlander camera is a line. They see a white and yellow ellipse as a bicolor segment. Like us, they have to go around the ellipse with their 1D camera. Like us, they can't see inside. Like us, they try to get an idea of 3D space by going around the bicolor ellipse without being able to see any hole. The lightning now. The ellipsoid is unlighted, but it is a 3D light coming after the projection. If we did the same with the circle, we would get an ellipse looking flat. The lighting of the circle is computed in 3D and only after the projection on the screen occurs. Let's do this way with the sphere. It is unlighted in the 4D space and we capture the result with our hyper camera. Now there are four areas which are the four possible combinations with one half unlighted and one half external. These four areas exist also on the circle. The bright white area is both external and illuminated. The dark white area is external but not unlighted. Now let's move on to the internal side. The bright yellow area is the illuminated part of the inner surface. And finally, dark yellow area is the inner surface which is not enlightened. Just as in 3D, you can add more lights. By turning the spotlight around, you can see that the spot unlights simultaneously the inner and the outer surface. It looks like there are two light sources. But there is only one. In 4D, the sphere has a hole through which the light enters. Returning to our original question about the hypersphere, we were stuck with this funny little brochette. But now, we know that spheres have the shape of an ellipsoid. By staking this ellipsoid, we get a ball as expected. It seems that the spheres are touching, but it is not the case. This is an optical illusion that can be detected by moving our hyper camera. The hypersphere is projected as a filled sphere because it's a volume. An hypersphere doesn't have any surface in the same way a sphere has no length. A sphere has a surface and a hypersphere has a volume. This is a 3D space. The surface of a sphere is closed. Any straight line on the surface returns to the starting point. Similarly, regardless the direction taken in hypersphere, we come back to the starting point. It is a closed 3D space. Now that we are a little more familiar with hyperspace, we can answer to the question asked earlier in the video. Why time could not be the fourth dimension of our world? Just because you exist. Exist does mean that you are still there second after second. In a 4D space-time, your 3D shape persists all along the black axis. So, in this space, you have the shape of a sausage. The whole world is a tangle of spaghetti. Time is certainly a fourth dimension, but space-time is a special kind of 4D space where the hypersphere doesn't exist. Thanks for watching.